should we go ahead and start? Do you have anybody online?
I've got three people online.
Okay, well, we need to start now.
Oh, I've got a bunch of people online.
Oh, okay.
Sonia, Cliff, Miriam, not a bunch, but a handful.
We need to start then. Morning, everyone. Thank you for coming today. And I think most of our participation is on Zoom today. So welcome to you all out in remote land. You won't be able to get a flower from us, but maybe you can appreciate a flower in your own yard. Announcements. Next Sunday is our last service before we take a summer break. We will not be having services here during the month of July, but we do have a game night and a day at Falling Water State Park planned. So if your name is not on the email mailing list to get the weekly bulletin, please be sure we have it so you can be apprised of these events. Next Sunday, our last service of the of this year, is our annual Poetry Day. Chris May is going to coordinate that. So that's where you get a chance to read your favorite poem or an original poem that you have written. And you probably need to see Chris, is that correct? Just show up. Just show up with your poem. Okay. Now we have the chalice lighting. Without light, there is no color, no rainbow, no flowers. As we light the chalice, we celebrate the light and all its gifts to the world. Our opening hymn is number 8. Mother Spirit, Father Spirit. It's one that we're not real familiar with, but I think we can sing it. If Ron, maybe we'll play it through once before we start singing.
Spirit, Father, Spirit, where are you? In the sky song, in the forest sound your cry. What to give you, what to call you, what am I? Man drops in mirrored ocean deep and sunlight bounces off the ripples to the sky. What to give you, what to call you, who am I? I am empty, time flies from me, what is time? Dreams internal, fears infernal, my heart. What to give you, what to call you, oh my God. Mother Spirit, Father Spirit, take our hearts, take our breath and let our voices sing our Take your hands and let us work to shape our heart.
Please note that hymn was written by Norbert Chavich. Let's see. I know I've got the name. Chavich. Norbert Chavich, who is the subject of our talk today. Sharing of joys and concerns. I'll start with a joy for Friday night's cultural cooking club, which was great fun here, where we got together and shared dishes inspired by Spain. Send your recipes to Sharissa. And the next one, which will be held in the fall, will be on the theme of Chile, not the dish, the country. I know we're all concerned, Ken, about Susie, who started chemotherapy, and of course that's a rough time. Did you want to say anything?
So yes, so Susie's having a rough time. She had her first chemo on treatment on Thursday. And it went well that day, but she's had a really rough time since, feeling very badly. And this morning, very sick, but I have someone there from home health care to be with her. I need to add something else that's not really great news either, sorry to say. Apparently I may have some sort of a health issue myself. It turns out that I've lost about 20 pounds without intending to lose any weight at all. And folks that I've shared this with have said, it's probably stress, and hopefully that's it. But my doctor's ordered several kinds of tests. I've had a chest x-ray and lots of blood work, and nothing turned up there. So next is a CT scan of the body and an out of schedule colonoscopy, which are always fun. Because the fear is, of course, that a likely culprit would be some sort of malignancy that didn't show up in the other tests. So I'm hoping for stress. Believe it or not, I really want it to be stress. But there was a time in my life that losing 20 pounds would have been an occasion for a major celebration. Probably not right now. So anyway, in your own UU way, pray for me and Susie. Thank you.
Yes, you and Susie are always in our thoughts, Ken.
It's kind of gotten to the point where it's not such a big deal anymore. But in my family, we now have, I think it's the 21st great-grandchild.
Jeff?
And I had a couple of concerns. One, just briefly, is that Florida Governor Ron DeSantis has failed, making us the only state out of 50 COVID vaccines for our youngest children. And I am deeply concerned by that action. And I'm a healthcare professional. I really like him to not take political position, but to allow physicians to children. I want to express that concern and just underscore that how important it is for us as individuals and as all different communities still be back to the speaking of young members of our community, the children of the Leadwood are going to have the opportunity to go to Oscar Chatterson this fall. This is the first time in 4 years since the hurricane that Oscar Chatterson will open as a school. And we have been invited, our fellowship has been invited
Our fellowship has been invited to participate in this opening of Oscar Patterson this fall by celebrating in August their Backpacks and School Supplies Day. They have a back to school day, and our board has committed to do that. And so next week, a week from today, the Sunday offering plate will be dedicated to the children of Patterson. And we want to help them gather the backpacks and school supplies it will take so that they can have a very positive experience. And we want to celebrate the reopening of Patterson. It's the only elementary school, the school for primary aged kids in the Glenwood community. And it's really a good thing that we have been able to rehab it after the hurricane and open it once again.
If you didn't hear Joe's first joy and concern, as she was regretting the fact that Governor DeSantis has made us the only state in the nation who is not distributing vaccines to young children. Any other joys and concerns? If not, we know there are some that are carried in your hearts and not said, and certainly we know those of you out listening remotely have your joys and concerns, and we want to share those with you as we have a moment of meditation, and then Ron will play and Matt will sing Spirit of Life, and you are welcome to sing along.
Spirit of life, come unto me, sing in my heart, currents of compassion, blow in the wind, rise in the sea. Shape of justice, roots hold me close, wings set me free. Spirit of life, come to me.
Time for All Ages story, and the name that I unfortunately stumbled over earlier, the story of Norman and Maya Chopik. Norbert. Stumbled over it again. Norbert Chopik was born about 150 years ago in Bohemia, which is now part of the Czech Republic. When he was young, he was sent to live with his uncle, who was a tailor like his father. And after working in the tailor shop for a while, he realized he didn't want to be a tailor. And after going to Catholic church with his uncle's family, he discovered that he preferred the Baptist church, where he could sing, talk about his ideas of God, and listen to a sermon spoken in his own language. His family was disappointed in both these things, but the Baptists sent him to seminary and he became a minister. Bohemia was strongly Catholic, and the police were suspicious of dissidents, such as this increasingly liberal Baptist minister. So Chopik and his wife and his 8 children moved to the United States. Unfortunately, his wife died soon after. And in his new life, Norbert went often to the New York Public Library to read, study, and write. And there he met a librarian named Maya, who was also a Bohemian expatriate. They were married in 1917. Maya introduced Norbert to Unitarianism, and he attended Unitarian Seminary, graduating in 1918, just as World War I ended. Bohemia became the core of the new independent country of Czechoslovakia, and the Čapeks went back there to start a Unitarian church. In 20 years, it became the largest Unitarian congregation in the world, and Maya also became an ordained minister. This popular church dispensed with most of the ritual and formality of the traditional church, and some people complained of a lack of spirituality. In response, in 1923, the Čapeks created a flower communion to symbolize the coming together of unique individuals into a community. Of course, then you know what happened in 1938. Nazis invaded Czechoslovakia. Norbert called for his fellow citizens to defend human dignity, freedom, and justice from violence, lies, and lawlessness. In 1939, the American Unitarian Association offered Norbert a position in the United States, but he chose to stay with his people. Maya did go to the U.S. to raise funds for Czechoslovakia and to take a job as a minister. In 1941, Norbert and his youngest daughter were arrested and convicted for listening to foreign radio broadcasts. While in prison, he continued to write and minister to fellow prisoners. He wrote many hymns during that period of time. As you heard, we sang the first one this morning, or one of them this morning. And I think that Reverend Ruth is going to continue this story when we have her recorded sermon. Right now, we are going to move into the offering. From you I receive, to you I give. Together we share, and by this we live. Thank you. Now, if we can get the recording going, we will hear from Reverend Ruth.
the worth and dignity of every human being, we find ourselves thinking of some persons as being less valuable than others. And we are at grave risk of neglecting responsibilities and committing deeds with dire consequences. Now, our wonderful, beloved children and youth are in here with us today, and we want our fellowship to feel comfortable and supportive for them. When we talk about scary stuff, we want to remind them and ourselves that here, today, we are safe. Would you say it with me? Here, today, we are safe. Many of us wore blue and yellow today as symbols of our support for the people of Ukraine who have been living under attack from their neighbors in Russia for over 2 months. War is a terrible thing, and the worst of its horrors are visited most intensely on the most vulnerable people in its wake. When I saw a video of all those young people, remember early on, the young people, parents and healthy, able children, walking miles to get to safety, I told my husband that the houses and apartment buildings in every town were still full. I knew they were full of the old and the sick and the disabled who could not flee and had nowhere to go. As I thought of my own son and his wheelchair at home, I could imagine all of those parents and caretakers in Ukraine with loved ones they could not move. War dehumanizes everyone. Inherent worth and dignity is stripped away from both attacker and victim. Russian soldiers who were lied to and convinced that they were defending their country against Nazi fascists starved and froze and watched comrades fall and losing their humanity became monstrous in the violence they inflicted. Ukrainians under attack are losing their humanity in their injury and anguish and now cry out for revenge and obliteration of their attackers. In movies, we can root for our heroes as they mow down monsters like orcs and zombies and evil robots. And we can do that without guilt or consequence. But in real life, everyone is a human being. Everyone in a war is a human being. Whether they're holding a gun or hiding in fear, or whether their body is lying in the street, in the field, these are all human beings. All of them beloved by other grieving human beings. No one wins a war. Everyone comes out losing, and the losses last for generations. Where have all the soldiers gone? Long time passing. Where have all the soldiers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the soldiers gone? Gone to graveyards, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will we ever learn? Let's say our safe phrase. Here today, we are safe. Reverend Norbert Čapek spent the last 20 years of his life in Czechoslovakia, from the end of the First World War to the middle of World War II. After the Nazis invaded his home country, he was encouraged to who returned to the United States, but he would not leave his church and the beloved friends he served. As he approached the age of 70, he decided to risk everything to continue in parish ministry there. Now, ministers aren't supposed to say this, but parish ministry is hard work. And Unitarian Universalists are a handful. I mean, we got to stand in line to know it all around here, right? We are a bunch of counterculture, earth-loving, sign-waving, hard-marching, sex-educating, politically active, civilly disobedient, society-shoving, world-changing, ornery as all get-out, well-intentioned, open-minded, open-hearted, open-armed, gentle, angry people. And being your minister requires the skills of a stand-up comedian, a lace maker, a pastry chef, and a circus ringmaster, among others. So when we think about old Norbert sticking around to minister to his parishioners of like disposition, I am sure, and writing sermons of hope and encouragement for them under the menacing eye of the Nazi occupying forces, we all might ask ourselves, would I have stayed? And in 1941, they came for him and put him in prison, where he continued to write and preach and encourage. And after a year at Dresden, old Reverend Norbert was sent to the concentration camp at Dachau. Survivors of that camp testified that he kept his fellow inmates' spirit up with humor and caring and cheerfulness. A Catholic priest imprisoned with him shared that Čapek achieved his greatest ministry there, among the despairing who lived in the very shadow of death. Without him, we could not have endured. After 4 months in Dachau, the Reverend Norbert Čapek was put to death in the fall of 1942. Wow, let's reassure ourselves and say our safe phrase, here today we are safe. I've seen the flower communion done in another church with no more than a cursory mention of the Čapeks. It was pretty, cheerful, pleasant. It did serve to help folk feel connected and encouraged, which was nice. But only nice is something of a disservice to old Reverend Norbert, isn't it? I mean, he could have left Czechoslovakia, retired, and joined his wife in the U.S. and lived many more years in reasonable comfort. He could have preached and written more hymns and done a lot of good for Unitarians of the day. He certainly could have left a powerful legacy and no one would have thought less of him. But he didn't do any of that. He stayed for those parishioners, those difficult and beloved church friends. He stayed because if Unitarian ideals were needed anywhere, they were desperately needed in that place and time. He stayed because long before the principles were written down and approved, he was practicing his heartfelt conviction in the inherent worth and dignity of every person, beginning with the person he was born, the people he was born with, and the aggressors from Germany holding his home country hostage. That conviction and that practice cost him his very life. Remembering his life and death and the life and work of Maya Čapek gives a gravitas to the flower communion, which enriches and challenges us all. A flower from someone else's garden creates a connection today with a neighbor. And that beautiful blossom reminds us of the price of a free faith. In a world leaning perilously close to authoritarianism once again. Reverend Chopic introduced the Flower Communion service 99 years ago to his congregation in Prague, when World War I was becoming a memory and World War II could not even be imagined. He understood the need for a symbolic ritual that would bring people together without reminding them of past injuries and other religious traditions. Reverend Chopic turned to the native beauty of the Czech countryside for elements of the communion which would be genuine to them. This simple ritual was so meaningful that it was repeated every year. The flower ceremony was later introduced to Unitarians in the United States by Reverend Maya Chopic. As we observe the ritual together, let us honor the memories of Norbert and Maya Chopic with gratitude for all they contributed to our free faith. Let us also remember those who are enduring the terrors of war now, our siblings in Ukraine and in other armed conflicts across the globe. As you select a flower to take home, let it remind you of the inherent worth and dignity of every person. Living out of that conviction is the beginning of peace. Where have all the graveyards gone? Gone to flowers, everyone. When will we ever learn? When will we? Amen. Shalom. Blessed be.
Okay, thank you. Maya Chopic wrote, "No two flowers are alike. No two people are alike. Yet each has a contribution to make. Each would help to make this world as beautiful as a colorful bouquet. By exchanging flowers, we signify that we are willing, in the spirit of tolerance and patience, to march together in search of truth, disregarding all that usually divides humankind." And now Juliana, in her flowery dress, is going to come and pass a basket of flowers around, and please pick one that you would like to take home to remind you of our common humanity. Thank you. Okay, and now let's turn to number 207 in the Gray Hymnal and sing number Earth Was Given as a Garden.
And tree of knowledge before our hearing reach. Here is home for all your creatures, born of land and sky and sea, all created in your image to in harmony. Alas, again the garden where all life flows fresh and free. Gently guide your sons and daughters into full maturity. Teach us how to trust each other, how to use for good our power, how to touch the earth with reverence, then once more we'll eat and flow. To earth and all your children, one creation, make us whole. To woven all our connected and to even hear much and love, knowing. In your word, and
oh wow,
fill us with infinite overflowing. Teach us how to live in peace.
Again, in the words of Maya Chopic, the exchange of flowers means that I shall walk without reservation with anyone, regardless of social status or former religious affiliation, as long as they are ready and willing to go along in the search of truth and service to humanity. And now we'll finish this service by singing Go Lift It Up.
Go lift it up. us your way. Moonlight, starlight, guide your journey into peace and the brightness of day.